My guest today is Shirley Williams, Secretary of State for Education and Science. It's hard to pin down a cabinet minister. They're busy people, as we all know, and Shirley Williams is no exception. She's also, I think, a reticent person, in sharp contrast to her mother, Vera Brittain, who poured her heart out in a book called Testament of Youth, first published in 1933. It's just been republished in hard and soft back. Shirley Williams, are we correct in saying that you are reticent in a way that your mother was not?
Not really, and I'll tell you why. My mother was actually extremely reticent when she met people. She was one of the truly reserved and shy people that I've come across, and I'm much less so. I think, therefore, that what impelled her to write Testament of Youth was a tremendously powerful force. It really drove through all her natural inhibitions against talking about herself, and particularly talking about her private loves and her private life. And it was this, I think, this sense of something driving her to do it that is quite central to understanding her, because she was, as I repeat, a very shy person. She couldn't have become, I think, a Member of Parliament. She simply wouldn't have enjoyed mixing to the extent that one does.
Because, you see, I mean, a writer, in fact, is an inward-looking person, basically, aren't they? And a politician must be an outward-looking person.
Yes.
So is that what you are, an outward-looking person, in a sense?
Well, in the sense that I like meeting new people, that it doesn't make me feel terribly tied up or bottled up or shy, yes. My mother wouldn't have found that so easy. She was somebody who had a very small number of very close friends, and then out beyond that, a very wide distant acquaintanceship. She much preferred communicating, for example, by writing letters than by talking or talking on the telephone. So I think there was quite a distinction, and I think that, like many writers, she found it possible to say in writing what she could never have said face to face.
When you knew her as a person, right, you know, I mean, other than accepting her as a mother, she was extremely famous because of Testament of Youth, wasn't she? Did that bother you?
Well, fame rather came and went for her. She was famous for a brief period, perhaps about 2 or 3 years after the publication of Testament of Youth. She was well known, though again not the way one is today, because there was no television and people didn't recognise her in the street because they'd perhaps seen a picture or two in the newspapers, quickly forgotten. Not the way that people's faces are now embedded, I think, in the memories of the general public. It just wasn't the case in those days. And of course, by the time that the war was coming, she was not so well known. She had begun to be less perhaps famous then, and it picked up again when she wrote Testament of Friendship about her great friend Winifred Helpby. But I don't think I had an oppressive sense of my mother being terribly famous, and because I had my father's name, not my mother's name, of course many people didn't associate Vera Brittain with a child called Shirley Catlin, and that probably helped quite a lot.
But now you are even more famous than your mother ever was, and do you think that can be a bother for your own daughter?
I think it could be. Luckily, I've got quite a common name. I would hate to be called Montmorency or something so that everybody said, ah, this is Jane Montmorency. That would be terrible. And that common name makes it much easier for her to simply be passed off as another girl. But I think it's very hard. Yes, I do. I think it's one of the nastiest aspects of public fame, that one's friends and relatives have to put up with being associated with that name, and I don't see why they should have to put up with that, really. I think it's very tough.
I mean, do you think that you help her by your own attitude to your fame? Because you seem very, if I could use the word, normal towards your fame, you know?
Well, to put it quite bluntly, I'm not impressed by it. I just do a job, I hope reasonably well. But if I did exactly, I mean, if I did a different job better, I would be less famous. Fame annoys me. I think it's absurd. I don't see why it's associated so much with particular jobs. If you're a politician, if you're an actress, if you're an actor, everybody sees your name, sees it in lights, sees your picture. If you're an engineer, if you're a brilliant teacher, if you're a clever researcher, if you're an outstanding scientist, few people know your name, nobody knows your face. It's absurd. It makes me angry. And I don't see, for one reason, why the fact that I'm a politician should mean that I have this much degree of public exposure, when if I was a much more able person who was, say, a scientist, probably 1% of people would ever have heard about me. I don't think it's right.
I think, though, people like to identify the public face with something that they perhaps quite like to feel about the possibility of them becoming famous in a way, though, you know. I think, although I can see what you mean about fame, I think there is another reason why people latch on to it in a way.
Well, perhaps, but in a sense, for example, if Marie Curie were living now, she would, I think, get nothing like the exposure that, say, a well-known actress gets. I still find that strange. Mm. Maybe scientists don't want exposure, but I'm not sure how many politicians want as much exposure as they get. Mm. And I would certainly, speaking for myself, prefer it to, if there were rather less public attention directed to me as distinct from my job, my work, the things I'm trying to do in the field of policy. Mm.
You mentioned your mother has been Vera Brittain, and in fact she was quite unconventional, wasn't she, and a very strong feminist, because she did not want to take on your father's name when she married him.
That was actually rather a common form of expression of feminist feelings at that time, that women fighting in a sense to have their own professional standing kept their own names as almost a gesture of saying, I'm going to do my own thing. But they went exactly, I think, like modern women's liberationists, in the sense that they were, on the whole, prepared to accept the idea that they remained largely in charge of the domestic responsibilities, although often they had more help in those days than they would now, especially middle-class women. Mm. But I think that they were almost never denied that they would have to carry that burden, and if they wanted to have careers or jobs, then that would be a second burden on top of the original one. Mm. In that sense, I think they were prepared to work terribly hard to be allowed to do something besides being a wife and mother.
She was unconventional about other things, though, wasn't she? I mean, she was sort of, what was the business of putting you outside in your underpants in bitterly cold weather? I mean, I couldn't quite work out what that was about.
Well, she was very conventional in some ways. That is to say, I don't think she would have had, I think, a traditional morality, for example. And fairly traditional religious beliefs. But she certainly shared some of the fashions at the time, and one of the fashions at the time, very strongly held, was that the best way to have a healthy child was to subject it to the climate at all times of the year in the open air. So, of course, if you survived that, you probably were rather strong. Maybe not everybody survived it, but it was a very strong fashion at the time. There was another one, I remember, which said that you must feed your child to the minute, every 4 hours or 6 hours apart. She didn't subscribe to this particular one. But even if the baby was screaming its head off, you always waited until the clock said it is exactly 2 p.m. and then you fed the child.
And then we got into demand feeding.
Long before. This was known as Dr. Truby King's recipe for upbringing of children. And it had this very strict, structured form to it.
I wondered whether some of her attitudes towards your education, for instance, that you went to, was it 8 primary schools, because she thought you had to experience all sorts. Very unsettling for a child, I think.
No, that wasn't her fault. That was a mixture of many things. That was partly the war. I happened to attend two schools that were bombed or damaged in the war, and so I was moved, evacuated somewhere else. I spent a couple of years in America. That was a different school. The school I came back to then had to close down, so I was sent to another part of the country. No, that really wasn't her fault. I think she would certainly have wanted to send me to at least, say, one progressive school, one state school, perhaps one academically inclined grammar school kind of school. But I don't think I'd have been to more than 3 schools if it hadn't been for the intervention of the war coming to the middle of things as well.
But did it unsettle you?
No, not really. I think I rather enjoyed it. I never spent longer than 3 years at any school. And I don't think it really did. But then, you see, in a way, one had to take on board the idea of being unsettled. I mean, if I was sent at the age of 9 to the United States by my, well, with my brother, but without my parents. I came back at the age of 12 in the middle of the war. I was interned for a month in Portugal when I was 13. One had to adapt to all sorts of oddities that don't normally happen to children. So maybe my frequent schooling was the best possible education for a world as disrupted as the world was for many children in the Second World War.
So why were you, in your words, a near delinquent when you were a child? I kept on putting it down to all the schools you went to.
No, I don't think so. I think it was part of the excitement of coming back from the relatively unscathed United States into the middle of the second Blitz and the V-bombers and so forth, and I found it very exciting. And with a group of friends, we simply charged around London into every burning building, presumably under the argument that we were looking for somebody to save, but I think actually because we found it very exciting, that kind of thing. And it was something, I think, about, you know, living in London during that time of the war, that if you were young and it didn't seem to be likely to affect you, it was a very exciting time to be there. Mm. So we simply roared about the place and behaved fairly badly, but the kind of thing I mentioned when I said I was a near delinquent was things like, you know, climbing up gutted churches and walking around the top of them, or climbing across the Bailey bridges and hanging from the middle in the middle of the Thames, that sort of thing. It wasn't violence or thievery. It was just, I suppose you'd say, extreme forms of mischief, basically.
You're a tomboy.
Oh, very much so.
Now, was that partly how your mother brought you up, do you think?
No. My mother was a very feminine woman in the sense of being very much not a tomboy. She was. She liked playing tennis, but she was not a skier or a climber of mountains or anything like that. No, I think she was probably a bit surprised. That was just chance. It was nothing to do with her upbringing. Except perhaps in one characteristic only, and that was that she had, of course, an absolutely firm view, which incidentally my father shared, that you brought up your sons and daughters with exactly the same opportunity. You expected both of them to help wash up. You talked in intellectual terms to both of them. You made no distinction between them on the grounds that little girls play with dolls and little boys play with engines. Both played with dolls or engines according to their fancy. And so in that sense, she didn't bring us up as if we were stereotyped according to our sex.
Because you were such a strong feminist, though, did that mean that your father had less or little to say in the running of the family and the house?
No, I wouldn't have said so, because of what I said earlier. That is to say that I think the feminists of that time were feminists in terms of their profession and their jobs. They very much accepted, by and large, the concept that the man was still head of the household, really, and that they were... At most, they might have sought a kind of partnership, but it was a partnership of a fairly traditional kind.
She had to fight really quite hard to get herself to Oxford, which she badly wanted to do, didn't she?
Yes.
Did that make her terribly determined that you should go to Oxford? Did you feel that pressure on you?
No, not very much so. Partly because the year before I went, I left school early. I left school when I was 17. And after that, I worked away from home for nearly a year in other parts of the country. I wanted to get to know the north of England, so I went up there to work for a while. And I wasn't living at home. But undoubtedly, my mother did want me to go to Oxford. I wanted to go to LSE. And what finally happened was that I got offered a place at Oxford, a scholarship at Oxford, and it seemed too good a chance to pass up. But there was, to that extent, a mild difference of opinion.
When you were evacuated to America, you nearly got the part of in National Velvet, which Elizabeth Taylor
she did.
Got. Now, would your mother have thought that was frightfully frivolous of you to have gone into acting?
She didn't really know much about it because, as I said, I was in the States on my own, and this was a purely kind of American enterprise of a very American kind. I think that probably she would have been a bit shaken if I'd suddenly been whizzed off to Hollywood to become an actress. But because she was a very long way away, and because you didn't ring up during the war, and because it took about 3 weeks or more for a letter to get anywhere, I doubt if she'd had any say in the matter. My foster parents in America would have been the determining factor. So I think if I had won the part in National Velvet, I might have been in the middle of taking the first rushes before my mother had even got to hear about it.
When you're poring over some dry paperwork, say, if you do get paperwork...
How much I do, yes.
Do you ever let your mind idle over the idea that if you'd got that part in National Velvet, what your difference it would have made to you?
I simply thank God I failed.
Really?
I would have hated to be a Hollywood actress. I think it's a desperate life, really. You become frightfully famous, your head gets turned, you get under the most colossal pressures, and then roughly halfway through your life, unless you're very fortunate, it all comes to a shattering end, and people start writing about how you're getting fat, or how you're no longer as glamorous as you were, or how your fourth husband is about to leave you, or something like that. I think that that kind of career is a terribly hard one. I think one gives one's youth a great chance at the price of sacrificing much happiness in your middle and old age. And I would much prefer a career which has the, if we might put it like this, rests at least in part upon characteristics which last one's life out and which do not die with one's youth.
Your mother was a great pioneer of the idea of a woman having a family and a job.
Right.
But don't you think that doing them both is sometimes such a slog that you have to sacrifice one part of your life?
I think it's very difficult. I think most women increasingly are involved in trying to make that work. And not surprisingly, often it doesn't. Something or other suffers. And I feel very strongly that one of the reasons why there aren't more women in Parliament is because as more and more women get married at some time in their lives, in other words, the spinster is really increasingly a person of the past, the problems of parliamentary life, which include certainly the length of the hours involved, the fact that so much evening work is involved, really make it very difficult for a woman with children anyway to be in the House of Commons. And by the time children are old enough for her to leave them for pieces of time, which really must mean something like secondary school, for more than, let's say, a few hours a day, by that time she's already getting a bit old to stand for the first time as a Member of Parliament or even as a candidate. So I do think it's very difficult, and I feel very strongly that one of the changes that society has to make is to accept that there should be more part-time jobs of real responsibility, that there should be more short shifts in industry, say, that there should be more attempts to try to meet the needs of women by, for example, shops opening at strange times of day or strange times of the week, because otherwise I think the strain is going to become really very serious. But I don't think you can push women back into the home once they've come out, because it's too exciting outside and they're not going to settle for it.
But do you have a feeling still that girls are leaving school slightly blank about their future, slightly diffident, or perhaps even too diffident about what they could do?
Yes, certainly. And I think this is partly because we still have too traditional a view of what women do. In other words, the group of, you know, be a secretary, be a nurse, work in a factory, be a shop assistant is usually gone through. And people still don't often suggest that a woman can go into management, go into engineering, go into technology. I think that is partly the fault of industry, which has been slow to take advantage of able and capable girls.
But they also make you feel that if you're going to come out, you know, have your family, that you're too old at 30 or 40
there's
to start to do something else.
Yeah. But even among young girls, I think there's the feeling that they'll chuck it in, so why should we start? Often men chuck it in, so it doesn't really operate like that, but the prejudice is there. And secondly, I think that there is undoubtedly the fact that many women are lacking in confidence, and this may be partly because their parents don't expect much of them, expect much less of them. One of the fascinating things will be to see whether the quite dramatic change in the balance of population, the surplus of men replacing the surplus of women, will in fact alter parents' attitudes towards their daughters once they begin to realise that their daughters are likely to be able to get married without too much trouble, instead of having to do everything in their power to get married because there are so few men to marry. That's an attitude, a hangover from the First World War, essentially.
A switch in subject slightly, but it's said that socialism owes more to Methodism than to Marxism, right? Do you think that it's more difficult for a Catholic to be accommodated in the Labour Party than a nonconformist?
No, not really. It's a good question. I suspect that probably a very substantial number of Catholics and a very substantial number of nonconformists
because you are a Catholic,
Labour Party.
Aren't you?
I'm a Catholic,
yes.
No, I don't think so. I've never really come across any very marked prejudice. You come across bits here and there. I'm sure the same would happen if I was Jewish. But I don't think you come across the kind of massive prejudice one does in other countries. And on the whole, I would say for Britain that I think it's a markedly religiously tolerant country. Full marks. I mean, the fact is that there has been very little reaction in terms of religious intolerance to the battles in Northern Ireland. I wish I thought we were as racially tolerant as I think we are religiously tolerant, but I think religiously we are tolerant, perhaps because for a lot of people religion is a rather distant idea, a nice thing that they think about just occasionally.
Is it difficult for you as a politician, though, and a Catholic, to actually think about abortion, about divorce, about birth control, say?
It would be if there weren't a free vote, but on the whole this has been accepted as an issue on which there should be free votes. I would find it difficult, I think many MPs would, if this whole area of what is sometimes called moral legislation, it also includes things like the attitude towards homosexuals, if all that changed and we were told there's a party vote on this, you've got to vote with a party, as happened sometimes in the past, I think that would present real problems. But providing it's kept as a free vote where each individual person can vote according to their conviction, then the fact that the majority of my party might take a different view on some of these issues, I think would not be seen by me as being a central difficulty.
A last question.
Yes.
If a woman became Prime Minister, how do you think it would change things?
It would change them in this really important sense, that an awful lot of girls would cease then to see the world in terms of it being run and organised and administered by men. they would begin to realize that women could be at the very top, and that might change a lot of attitudes.
You'd hate to be asked if you were asked to be Prime Minister, would you, wouldn't you?
I wouldn't be very keen on the job.
You wouldn't? No. Well, thank you very, very much indeed for talking to me today.